Election Forum on the Environment. This is a forum, I hasten to add, not a debate. We'll go through some of the rules in a couple of moments, but I wonder if Chris Ryder from CPAWS is around here and he'd like to make a few opening remarks.
Thanks, Dave. Good evening. First, before we move on, as usual, I think it's important to acknowledge that we're on the traditional territory of the T'ankwa'chan Council and the Kwanlundun First Nation. We thank them for allowing us to be here on their territory today, and we're extremely grateful as always. Next, I want to say thank you so much to everyone who's come out tonight. And thank you to everyone who's watching from the communities on the live stream. We're so happy to see so many faces here, so many people passionate about the environment. This is going to be, I think, a really great night. I think it's, I've been told, going to be the best forum that does not involve Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton that's going to happen this month. So I think you're all in for a treat. Tonight is going to be such a important night because this is such a critical juncture for the environment. There's so many major issues on the table right now. Everything from the fate of the Peel to land use planning to how we're going to deal with climate change, and all the different parties have different plans on all these different items. And I'm really excited to be able to give all of them an opportunity to speak about those different plans. And so that everyone can be informed and make a decision based on everything that they have to say tonight. Looking forward to some really great questions from the environmental community and from the audience tonight. And before I go off and hand back to Dave, I just want to say thank you, Dave, for agreeing to be our host tonight. We're looking forward to some... We're looking forward to some great jokes and maybe comedy in between. And thank you so much to Liz Hanson, John Streicker, Dan Macdonald, and Kristina Calhoun for all agreeing to represent your parties tonight. I can't wait to hear from all of you. And thank you very much.
That's Chris Ryder, everyone. So as I mentioned, this is a forum, not a debate, so everybody gets an equal opportunity to answer questions, to put their party's ideas forward. It's a little bit different in that the first part of the forum will consist of questions from various environmental groups that have already been submitted. Representatives of the groups are here, and they'll be able to ask their questions to the candidates. And in the second part, it's the questions from the public. So we're asking people to write the questions down, and they'll be gone through so that, you know, not everybody is asking the same question about the same thing. If you haven't submitted a question and you'd like to, or if you hear something in the first half that raises a question for you and you'd like to get that in, you can put that in during the break, which means there will be a break, which is, you know, nice, I guess. And if you don't feel like you'd like to ask your question into the microphone, then I'll ask it for you. So please don't use any big words when you write it down. Okay, so we have an opening question, and we did the very sophisticated Yukon drawing numbers out of a ball cap thing to decide who gets to go first. Each question, it's going to be, it's a little bit different. The opening statements will be 2 minutes long, and then the response to each question will be 90 seconds. We'll move them around a little bit so everybody gets to go first, everybody gets to go last, hopefully. Math was never my strong suit, so who knows what'll happen. So once again, we drew from a hat, and Danny Macdonald from the Yukon Party gets to go first. And if I could just, I mentioned this on the radio, I did an interview with somebody. I think everybody who's on stage as a candidate does deserve a round of applause, and everybody who's a candidate in this campaign deserves a round of applause, because these folks, they work real hard. They're, you know, the walking is treacherous, and there are people out there tonight slipping all over the place, knocking on doors, and that's why we get to vote, because people get to put their names forward. So I do actually admire all these people. That was pretty good. Maybe I'll run. All right, so once again, this is the opening question. Everybody gets a chance to answer it. We'll start with Danny Macdonald of the Yukon Party. Here is the question. The environment is what makes the Yukon a great place to live. There's a rule when camping that you leave your campsite even better than when you found it. How will you do this for the Yukon's environment? Here we go.
Thank you, Dave. And thank you, Chris, for recognizing the traditional territories. Thank you, everyone, for attending and the organizers. I'm happy here to be here as the Yukon Party rep on the panel. And the environment is important to all of us who live here in the Yukon. I feel that the Yukon Party has a good story to share that represents the position of many Yukoners, so I'm happy to be here to represent that. In advance, I'd like to thank everyone for a respectful discussion and look forward to hearing from attendees. The Yukon Party believes that we don't have to choose between the environment and a flourishing economy. We support responsible resource development in our territory, and we feel we can accomplish this while caring for the important wilderness and wildlife here. And while there remains more work to do, our Yukon environment is without a doubt better now than it was when this party first took office. And here's why. We created green jobs to assess and remediate contaminated sites that we inherited under the management of Diane in Ottawa. We have expanded the protected areas to amongst the highest in the country, with more than 57,000 square kilometers now protected. And the Yukon Party's implementation of the Climate Change Action Plan and establishment of the Climate Change Secretariat have led Yukon's efforts to tackle climate change. Going back to site assessment, the Yukon Party established the Site Assessment and Remediation Unit to evaluate, cost out, and plan the work to remediate contaminated sites around the territory. Since 2011, $15.5 million has been invested to remediate sites across the territory. Those are green jobs. We worked with First Nations to implement the many protected areas that are specifically identified in the individual final agreements. And we have worked through the four pillars of the Climate Change Action Plan and completed or are in progress on all of them from the 2009. There are 28 more from the 2015 Climate Change Plan. And we've worked to improve access for Yukon families to campgrounds and our experience in our wilderness. Thank you. There remains more work to do, but we are committed to doing it.
Thank you, Danny. The bell is the signal. You'll hear the bells, and that's a 30-second bell. It's a 2-minute bell. It's just a 2-minute bell here.
There we go.
John Streicher.
Thanks, Dave. Thanks to CPAWS and YCS for inviting us to be here today. We just drew this order, so I have something written down, but I'd actually like to say that if we're checking the campsite rule, I'm not sure that we're better off 14 years, over the past 14 years. When I came here decades ago, I hiked up to the face of the Kaskwalsh Glacier, and I fell in love with this place. And it was because of what it's like to all of us and what it means to all of us. And now that glacier's flowing a different way out a completely different watershed, and Kluane is changing completely. So I'm not sure that, we've dropped our emissions a little bit, but it's only because our economy's going down the tube. So I don't believe that we're in a better place, but I agree that the right way to do this is to stop pitting the economy against the environment. And that's what the Yukon Liberals believe. That's our number one thing, is when we put out our platform, we're showing how the environment and the economy should be working hand in hand, that we should find ways to plan far out into the future, to create a sustainable future so that we don't have this situation where we're competing, and especially when we're in sort of a boom-bust type cycle with a resource-based economy. So it is really important that we treat the environment as give its due, and the social fabric of the territory as well, not just the environment. Thanks. The other thing that I think is really important, and what the Yukon Liberals are emphasizing, that it is critical that we get back to government, or we create, or we live up to the land claim agreements and the umbrella final agreement, that we have respectful government-to-government relationships with all orders of government, in particular First Nations governments. Thank you.
Thank you very much, John. And now Liz Hanson.
Thanks, Dave. My thanks to CPAWS and YCS for organizing this event. The issues discussed tonight define Yukon's future. That is why I'm here with you tonight. I believe that anyone who wants to be premier should be here tonight. We all love the place where we live. We choose to live here for a quality of life you can't get anywhere else. We want our children and children's children to be able to experience wild spaces, clean air and water now and for generations to come. But more and more, that future is at risk. We are at a watershed moment. We can continue with the failed ideas of the past, or we can make better choices for future generations. We need to make better choices when it comes to the peel, to fracking, to renewable energy. As leader of the Yukon NDP, I am proud to say that the NDP has committed to establishing a green energy investment fund, a fund that will build to $50 million over 5 years. The NDP has supported the final recommended peel plan from day one, and an NDP government will work with First Nation governments, industry, community, and NGO partners to jumpstart and complete land use planning throughout Yukon. As New Democrats, we have heard Yukoners, we have heard First Nations people, we have heard the scientific community. An NDP government will ban fracking, not impose a temporary moratorium. Over the past 5 years, the Yukon NDP has traveled throughout the Yukon, listening and learning from you. We acknowledge the wisdom and creativity of Yukoners, essential elements to moving to a renewable energy future for Yukon, a future where as good campers, temporary travelers on this land, we leave no trace.
Thank you, Liz.
And finally, Kristina Calhoun.
Good evening. Each and every one of us in this room here tonight impacts the environment, not just locally, but globally. Many of us in this room here tonight go out of our way to consume less, to recycle responsibly, and to leave as small of an ecological footprint as we possibly can. But the fact remains that the consumptive and energy-intensive lifestyles that many of us lead have to change. This is where government should be leading. When we find that many individuals are taking as many actions as they can to conserve the environment, and yet industry and others are carrying on business as usual, this is where a government can make real progress, if only they have the intelligence and the will. If Greens are elected, or even if any of our green policies are adopted, the Yukon Green Party could leave the Yukon environment a better place by completely changing the outlook of Yukoners and businesses operating in Yukon from one of utilization, extraction, and monetary gain to one of respect, sustainable management, and resource revenue sharing. In many areas of existing legislation, we have tons of excellent policy, but we lack strict enforcement. A green-influenced government would redistribute department funds in order that more of each department's budget goes to hiring enforcement officers, enforcing legislation, ensuring that fines and penalties are upheld, and in some cases increased. We would transfer all current subsidies from polluting and environmentally damaging industries to environmentally, socially, and economically net positive industries. And we would develop with great enthusiasm a new mining boom for the territory. The surface mining and reclamation of all Yukon territorial landfills and transfer stations. In our green vision of a healthy and diverse Yukon environment and economy, we see a territory that prospers through stewardship of our geographical, natural, and renewable resources and a proportionally representative government that acts in the best interest of both current and future generations of Yukoners.
Thank you. All right, we have a few people who are looking for seats, and there are some seats, so if you would like to come down and make some new friends, talk about the environment, come down and do that. All right, so now we're going to move on to the questions, and I have a list, and we're going to start with Karen McKenna. She's the Vice President of the Board of CPAWS Yukon. They've organized this, so they get to go first. So where is Karen? She's already got
right
a mic.
Here
we go.
Okay. A recent study from the University of Queensland found that since the early 1990s, the Earth has lost 10% of its remaining wilderness. The same study identified that Canada's northern boreal forests are amongst the world's most critical wilderness regions. Here in the Yukon, we are lucky to be to still be surrounded by forests, rivers, and mountains that are the traditional territory of Yukon First Nations and which provide a home to large populations of wildlife and many rare plants. Unfortunately, as things currently stand, there is no overall strategy in place to identify and protect critical wilderness areas across the territory. What will your party do to ensure a systematic approach to the protection of our valuable wilderness?
Thank you very much. All right, John Streicher gets to go first.
Thanks, Karen. So the first thing that we want to do is to create a round table with First Nations, the territorial government, NGOs, industry, etc., as a group that is going to tackle some of these big questions and do sustainable planning into the future. We have also sat down and talked about what needs to happen in order to protect our wilderness, and we think the most important thing is to develop our land use planning and to get it back on track. We need to get land use planning out of the courts. We need to adopt the Peel Land Use Plan as it was proposed by the Peel Land Use Planning Commission. And we need to get land use planning back on track all over the map. We think that land use planning is the proper tool in which to start to identify for everybody, for proponents, thank you, for citizens, NGOs, for everyone, for those of us that are wanting to protect wilderness, to look to see how we should develop our land. And that goes from broad land use plans down to little local area plans. So we think that's the right way. We also will introduce a Species at Risk Act to identify those species and areas which are critical and need to be protected. Thank you very much.
Liz Hanson.
Curious. I think, in fact, that we do have a process. It's called land use planning, and it's covered in Chapter 11 of our final and land use, our final agreements with First Nations, because conservation of wild spaces is a key result of land use planning, a process that was agreed to by all levels of government in Yukon's land claims agreements. Like the Yukon NDP has stood side by side with First Nations governments, concerned environmental community groups, and all Yukoners in support of the final recommended Peel plan. And we were unwavering in our support of that plan, not just because it is the result of extensive multi-year consultation that amassed vast amount of scientific, geologic, economic, and sociocultural data, but the message of the Peel plan guides all land use planning, in which they said it would help us to visualize and achieve the kind of future we want. The basic premise of the plan is to preserve options for the future. We can always decide to develop in the future, but once the decision is made, we cannot return to a pristine ecosystem and landscape, not in our lifetimes and not in the lifetimes of our great-grandchildren. We have said that we would respect and understand the importance of First Nation environmental groups pursuing their position before the Supreme Court of Canada, as it will set out the responsibility of future governments to behave in a way that honors our final agreements and the land use planning process.
Kristina?
Thank you. So definitely within our policy book, which you can find at our website, yukongreenparty.ca, we do also refer to land use planning as being most vital in that we have to establish the values, the assets, the liabilities of the land before we go ahead and develop, and then we don't understand what we've even, what was the most valuable asset that we may have overlooked. So we agree on those points. Another point in our policy is that we would enshrine the right to a healthy environment in the Human Rights Commission in their mandate. So that in itself, we believe, would offer much protection for our land and for our wildlife. We'd also increase our parks and protected areas, which Danny was mentioning. The Yukon Party feels they have a large amount. We feel that we would increase it to 20% of the land base over the next 10 years. And we would eliminate sport and trophy hunting of at-risk animals. And we would also pass strong species at-risk legislation that includes appropriate habitat protection and creates jobs in all Yukon communities that monitor pollution, protect species at risk, and enforce fish and wildlife protection. So many steps to the process that we would go through, starting with, I believe, the most important, which would be enshrining the right to a healthy environment in the Human Rights Commission mandate.
Thank you, Kristina. Danny Macdonald.
Thank you. As I noted, the Yukon Party has taken its lead from the final agreements, and the parks, special management areas, and habitat protection areas, we have worked collectively with First Nations to develop management plans for those areas, which has led to the current level of protected areas. Any new areas would come through the land use planning. I agree with the other parties on this, and as demonstrated in the North Yukon plan, there was areas identified in that plan. So that is the work that would work cooperatively with First Nations and through the land use planning process. And as well, we have to recognize that it has to be responsive and active management on our plan in those areas where it's not currently planned for. And the Fish and Wildlife Management Board, our Renewable Resource Councils, and the Environmental and Socioeconomic Assessment Board actually provides an opportunity for everyone to collectively be involved in the planning process to look after our fish and wildlife and some of our areas. So that currently is our tools that are at our opportunity to use and to work with First Nations and other organizations to do so.
Thank you, Danny. Now we're looking for Megan Christie, president of the board of the Yukon Conservation Society, with her question.
Thank you. I just wanted to say thank you to all four of you for being here, and beyond that, for all the work that you're doing as candidates right now.
Oh, sorry. So all the parties have stated where they stand on a carbon tax and renewable energy investments, but can you tell us what are the key components of your climate change strategy and how you would fund them?
Ms. Hanson.
Thank you. Well, as Yukoners, we know that climate change is real. It is our lived experience. And in Yukon, we have the data. Our temperature has already increased by 2 degrees Celsius over the past 50 years, and our winters have warmed by 4 degrees over the same period. Just this summer, we saw the impact of the melting of another glacier in Yukon, and we're learning more about the impact of melting permafrost on infrastructure, roads, and our buildings. It's not enough to say it's someone else's fault. We need to do our part. A Yukon climate change strategy must take real action to transition from greenhouse gas-emitting fossil fuels to renewable energy sources. Carbon pricing is an important tool in that strategy. The Yukon NDP plan for implementing carbon pricing is based on the principle that it must provide rebates for low and middle income families and provide for the establishment of a renewable energy investment fund. Investments in renewable energy are key to good jobs and climate change actions. The $50 million over 5 years for our Green Energy Investment Fund will be an integral part of our climate change policy. Climate change is too important to make it a political football like the Yukon Party does, and it's too important to have shifting positions like my colleagues, the Liberals. Thank you.
Thank you. Kristina Calhoun.
Thank you very much for your question and also for appreciating that we're all here. So as you mentioned, we do support a carbon tax of $30 per ton, increasing by $10 per ton per year. And the way that we would fund that is we want to leave the carbon tax. We know we need a carbon tax. We want to leave a lot of that up to you, Connor. So we have different ways you can implement a carbon tax. One way is a fee and dividend system where Yukoners get money back based on the income from the carbon tax. And another way is revenue neutral. So what you would do then is you would shift those taxes over to the carbon tax itself. So that's one way that our strategy would work towards that. And then again, another tax shift. A lot of our climate change policy is tax shifting. So we don't want taxes on things that we like jobs and businesses. We want to shift those taxes away from jobs and businesses and put those on polluting industries. And anything with habitat destruction. So then our next step would be to transfer all current subsidies from oil, gas, mining, and other large industries to net positive programs. and we would also actively participate in the Western Regional Climate Action Initiative. So many processes to this as well, and we do have it costed out, and we do have the money part figured. So check out our website.
Thank you, Kristina. Danny, all the way down. Yeah, it's not the most efficient system, but you know what?
We'll make it work.
Danny Macdonald.
Thank you, Megan. So the Yukon Party has been clear that we believe we can take action on this, on climate change, with aggressive government action and investment in retrofitting and affecting our transportation sector. We have announced a number of initiatives that we've committed to as a re-elected Yukon Party government that will significantly lower emissions, both from government and putting programs in place. Most recently, the announcement of the Green Energy Program that will be doubled, that is oversubscribed and will allow Yukon businesses and residents to retrofit their homes and reduce their emissions and their energy consumption. This is all going to be accomplished without putting the burden on the backs of Yukoners with a carbon tax. That's a key element. We feel that up here, the solution is significant investment by government in order to affect the change that we require. We are disproportionately experiencing the impacts, and we are already seeing the costs. So a large portion of our plan is also adaptation. You will see the establishment of a permafrost research center at the Yukon College that has been committed to, which is a stepping stone to the establishment of a climate change degree as part of Yukon University and leading the research sector for climate change as well. Thank you.
Finally, John Streicher.
Thanks, Megan. So this is the Vancouver Declaration. It was signed in March by our premier. I circled him there on the front. Here inside, it says that first ministers commit to transition to a low-carbon economy by adopting a broad range of domestic measures, including carbon pricing. So we signed up for it, and I think we would like to stand up with Canadians and the world and do our part. The question is, how do we do it without burdening Yukoners with that price on carbon? And it is a tax is the only way that we do it here. So it's a little, I don't think it's very leader-like for the Yukon Party to be talking, to be using fear. We've said rebate it to Yukoners. I'm still waiting to hear what the Yukon Party will do with it, because it's a federal tax, it's coming. We are saying the Liberals will invest not $10 million a year, as the NDP is suggesting, in renewables. And it was $10 million by the Yukon Party, now up to $16 million a year. We're saying $30 million a year into renewables around conservation and its heating. So when you look at our energy spectrum, the place where we have a dependency on fossil fuels is home heating and building heating, and that's what we need to change.
Thank you, John. All right, we're looking for John Carney of the Yukon Fish and Game Association. Question about outdoor recreation and conservation education. John?
I'm John Carney, and I'm representing Fish and Game as a member, not on any other thing. Anyhow, I could read the question the way it's written here, but it's a little difficult for me. But the Fish and Game Association is a conservation organization. It was started just before the end of World War II, and Alex Van Bibber would have been a member then, but he was still in the war, so he joined up right afterwards. And Alex, who lived to be the ripe old age of 98 a couple years ago, he started several decades ago an outdoor education camp. And through that camp, he taught youth about the values of conservation and the respect for wildlife, the respect for nature. And the Fish and Game Association would like to keep that type of legacy of Alex's going with a facility, a camp, that we'd like to see other groups use, whether it's First Nation groups, other youth groups, scouts, guides, education schools, for outdoor education and for conservation. So the question is, what is your position on the importance of conservation education for outdoor recreationists And what action would you take to help us realize a goal of developing an outdoor education facility in the Yukon?
All right, thanks very much. I will start with Kristina Calhoun on this one.
Thank you for your question. We have, again, several things in our policy, which it's unfortunate we have 90 seconds to answer. But what we do mention is integration of this very item that you're discussing into school curriculum, so bringing back outdoor education right within the school curriculum. We want to prioritize reskilling programs, hunting, sewing, canning, growing, land-based learning, these type of things. And we want to see that every child in Yukon knows edible and medicinal wild plants. We want them to know, you know, what to do with them, and we want every child to know the value of all living things as being equal to themselves. So obviously a Yukon Green Party government would be more than supportive of the outdoor education facility that you're speaking of. We want to promote outdoor recreation and respect for outdoor and outdoor activities. We would be promoting decarbonized recreational activities before we would ever promote any carbonized recreational activities. And obviously we'd like to see this back in every school, because although we believe it's very important that there is a facility, as you're mentioning, we also believe that it's very important that every community has access to this. And so putting it in the schools and making sure that every community can access it is a priority for us as well.
Thank you. Danny Macdonald.
Thank you. This question is related to, some of this work is already underway, and I think that's part of the work that the Yukon Party has done to implement traditional First Nation culture into our schools. We see that these sort of camps are undertaken, and I know from my own experience, I was up in Old Crow and had the opportunity to visit Muskrat Camp, where students spent a week living in wall tents and going out and having an elder demonstrate to them traditional muskrat trapping exercises, and they lived a more traditional lifestyle in a trapping camp. That, and then you have also the bison hunts that take place in a number of different schools. But that work will continue with the Yukon Party's commitment to a Made in Yukon curriculum. It will incorporate traditional experiences on the land and the opportunity to incorporate First Nation traditional experiences as part of our Made in Yukon curriculum. So this work is underway and will be incorporated more when the Yukon Party's plan for a new curriculum comes into place. Thank you.
Mr. Streicker.
Thanks, John. So the Yukon Liberals believe in outdoor education, and we have built it into our platform. And I think, though, I'll expand just a little bit. We think that there are, it isn't just through education. We also believe that there are ways in which to embrace conservation values and to connect us with the land through more than just public school education. We also believe in investing in research in the territory, including through traditional knowledge research. And we also believe that tourism, that the future of tourism is to move towards cultural-based tourism and environmental-based tourism and arts-based tourism. So a tourism which allows people to experience what we experience and what we value here, and rather than sort of the old style of tourism which doesn't really pay as much attention to the land. So we think there are a suite of ways that the Yukon Liberals will increase our values and our conservation of wilderness here in the territory.
Thank you, John. Liz Hanson.
Thanks, John, for the question. And, you know, it's in addition to the work, ongoing work in terms of experiential education, which NDP governments established many years ago, I think it's important to recognize and applaud the work of the Fish and Game Association for its educational work that it's done. And it would be fitting in my mind to recognize the sort of legendary figure of J.J. Van Bibber, who we all recognize in terms of the book Born Under a Spruce Tree. I mean, J.J. Van Bibber was involved with traditional camps for many, many years as a teaching traditional knowledge, is also as a trapping instructor for over four decades. And it's my understanding he led his final outdoor camp 2 years before his death, I think in his mid-90s last year. So one of the real challenges, I think, that I've heard about what the Fish and Game Association has been dealing with is actually finding a space, a small space to run this camp. I think that it's quite plausible that as a Yukon NDP government, that we could work with the Fish and Game Association to ensure that the Fish and Game Association will have a leasehold in order to establish a camp that would be in recognition of the dedicated decades of work of J.J. Van Bibber.
Thank you. Vern Peters of the Trails Only Yukon Association has a question about ATV legislation, I understand.
Thank you very much, and thank you for this opportunity, and thank you to the candidates for running. A large majority of Yukon people think it's far past time to act effectively to manage ATVs in the Yukon wilderness. For the past 5 years, there's been a lot of talk about the issue, but absolutely no real action on the ground to protect sensitive habitat and wildlife from the impact of irresponsible ATV use. Here is my question. If elected, will you support and promote the enactment of necessary legislation and regulations to effectively manage ATVs in the Yukon wilderness within the first 24 months of a new government mandate? Thank you.
Thank you, Vern. Danny Macdonald.
Well, good news on this front. The changes were made to the Territorial Lands Act to give new tools to target areas of concern. They have not been enacted in regulation yet. The new options include restricting or prohibiting the use of off-road vehicles within specific areas, imposing operating conditions applicable to off-road vehicles within specific areas, the issue of permits for off-road vehicles, and terms and conditions of those permits, and the development, approval, and implementation of trail plans for off-road vehicles in specific areas, which could limit creation and growth of new trails. Those tools are now permitted in legislation. They have not been implemented. A re-elected Yukon Party government will work with First Nations and stakeholders to develop a process for using these tools, taking into consideration the importance of users and uses including recreation, hunting, trapping, outfitting, resource industries, and tourism. And we will also ensure the regulations are inclusive and do not exclude anyone to the advantage of another group. Thank you.
Thank you. John Streicker.
Thanks, Vern. So I spoke earlier about our approach, the two-pronged approach to keep the economy and the environment working together, and also about working in a respectful government-to-government relationship with First Nations. And I talked about this sustainability task force on economy and the environment. You know, we had the Yukon Council 7 years ago. It went by the wayside. So the Yukon Liberals commit to a proactive approach, a territory-wide approach, we're not committing to having legislation within the first 24 months, but what we will commit to is getting this issue on the agenda within the first year to that group to start to treat it. Now, I want to be careful because I don't want to commit that group yet to hitting legislation within 2 years, but that group will then report back to us within that first 24 months, and then we'll take it from there once we see what they come up with. But yeah, we're committed to addressing this issue.
Liz Hanson.
Oh. Okay. We applaud the work of Toya, and thank you for recognizing the Yukon NDP with the only A in your recently reported published report card. The vast majority of ATV users are responsible. They know that some sensitive areas need to be protected. The Yukon NDP supports the work of the Select Committee, a Select Committee that completed its work before the last election. That's why I'm a little frustrated here. And We have worked hard over the last 5 years to make this issue a priority in the Legislative Assembly. So 6 years after the Select Committee on Off-Road Vehicles, and despite the fact that changes to the Territorial Lands Act have been made, there isn't a single sensitive area that is protected. The NDP has asked questions about this every year since the last election, but like many of you, we haven't got any answers. The Yukon NDP party is the only party that has made this a priority. It's the only party that is committing to acting during our first term in office to actually implement these recommendations and to get on with protecting sensitive wilderness areas, particularly in the shoulder seasons. Thank you.
Kristina?
I want to answer your question very simply. Yes, the Yukon Green Party will enact legislation and regulations that would be proactive and would be comprehensive territory-wide within the first 24 months of our mandate. We do feel this is a high priority. We do need to protect wildlife and protected areas. And we would go one step further in that currently in our policy, we would encourage the use of energy-efficient off-road vehicles, such as four-stroke or electric vehicles, for use as utility aids in transportation through special licensing and low-cost registration. And unfortunately, we're finding ourselves in a time where we have a scientifically proven catastrophic climate change occurrence coming upon us, so it's not really the time to be promoting recreational use of anything that is fossil fuel powered. So we would support the hard work that you have been doing through your group, but we would also encourage you to take it a step further where transportation, utility aids, fishing, hunting, great. Recreational, not so great. Thanks.
Thank you. Is Jim Kenyon around? Jamie, sorry. All right. Jamie's from Ducks Unlimited, and he has a question about water strategy and wetland policy.
Yes, thank you, and good evening to the candidates. Wetlands are valuable ecosystems that provide Yukoners with numerous ecological goods and services, including wildlife habitat, clean water, and carbon storage. Currently, the Yukon lacks a wetland policy that provides clear guidance for maintaining these ecological goods and services to industry, boards, councils, bureaucrats, and the public. The lack of guidance that would be provided by a wetland policy has caused uncertainty for Yukon's economy and environment. Such a policy has been promised in Yukon's water strategy and is yet to be completed. My question is, if elected, will your government honor the commitment made in the water strategy and make the development and implementation of a wetland policy a priority? If so, can you tell us a bit more about what steps and actions you and your party would take to ensure that these critical ecosystems are effectively managed and the values wetlands provide Yukoners are maintained? Thank you.
And a reminder to please turn off your cell phones. John Streicher.
Thanks, Jamie. So the answer is yes. The Yukon Liberals will develop a policy for managing Yukon wetlands, including support for inventory and monitoring, and also differentiating between natural wetlands and wetlands which have been created through industrial practices like mining. And again, we would want to work, so to answer the second part of your question, which says, you know, how would we go about it? Again, we believe that this is done best in partnership with other governments, in particular First Nation governments. And we know this has been outlined under the Yukon Water Strategy, and we are committing to it. You asked also whether we have a sense of the importance of wetlands. So again, yes. I think it was interesting this week to, well, let me just say about us. I think that we're an evidence-based group. We want to use evidence-based decision-making rather than ideology what was the term? I can't remember now, but it got pulled back, so I'm not sure. But anyway, yeah, thanks. Yeah, so we have And we want to invest in research as well here in the territory. We believe that that's, we think we need research chairs, right? We recently got one for energy. We think we need one for other issues like environment.
Liz Hanson.
Thank you very much. The simple answer is yes. The Yukon NDP has in fact raised serious concerns about the water strategy developed by the Yukon Party. The strategy put industrial use of water ahead of any other purpose and raised concerns about its consistency with Chapter 14 of the Umbrella Final Agreement. When it comes to a wetland policy, this is another example of Yukon Party inaction that has created conflict. In fact, it was the Klondike Placer Miner Association that highlighted the need for a wetland strategy to avoid conflict. Now we have the Yukon Party taking the Water Board to court because it says the Water Board didn't respect the government's decision to exclude sensitive wetlands from a mining project at Indian River near Dawson. So what's the point of an arm's-length body if they're not allowed to fulfill their mandate to water first? This is the same pattern the Yukon Party established when they secretly put forward amendments to YESA, but in this case they just went straight to court. We believe that this energy fighting court battle should go to creating good policy. An NDP government will create a wetland policy. The steps will include, in fact, going back and pulling out of the files the draft wetland policies that have been on the books created by professional public servants over the last number of years. The work has been done. We need to act on it.
Kristina? You're doing a great job handing the mic around, John. I just want to commend you on that. Yeah. Go ahead.
All right. With an ever-dwindling supply of water on the planet and the recognition that water is a basic necessity of life, the Yukon Green Party proposes to elevate water to the most valuable commodity that the Yukon has and the most stringently protected commodity that the Yukon has. So, yes, we would commit to a wetland policy, and we would also protect the peel, remove the ability for Yukon Waters to have any claim of sovereignty by any other jurisdiction or corporation through resisting bulk water exports. We would also prioritize the protection, filtration, and infrastructure maintenance required for ensuring a drinkable freshwater supply. And we would create multi-skill level jobs in all Yukon communities, from waterway cleaners up to monitors and managers, and then right on up the chain to water testing, enforcement, and research positions to ensure that all these, and we would ensure that all of these positions can be certified locally through Yukon College or through distance learning. So definitely we take the water here in the Yukon as a priority, and we want to assure you that we would right away consult with you, the experts, and we would work very closely with you to commit to a Yukon wetland policy.
Finally, we'll hand the microphone down to Danny Macdonald.
Thank you. Well, going back to the last election, the water strategy was a commitment from the Yukon Party, and they have completed that. And as you noted, a wetland policy is a further step, and that's one of the next steps outlined in the water strategy. First, part of the water strategy is understanding our water resources, and we've installed new watering monitoring systems across Yukon, dozens, especially at key locations, including tributaries. And this is enabling us to understand our water resources in the territory better than we ever have before, and particularly our groundwater resources. And our wetlands are a key part of this and understanding them. So a re-elected Yukon Party government will take the next step to implement a wetland policy, and will engage with stakeholder groups, First Nations, communities, and our resource councils, as well as industry groups, to determine that the policy is includes an inventory and a map of wetland area values, and it is also done properly by engaging all stakeholders and collecting scientific data to make that done. Thank you.
Thank you, Danny. Our next question comes from the group Yukoners Concerned. Don Roberts is the chair.
Thank you very much, and I really appreciate the candidates for sitting here and asking these questions, because we all know that this is all about Yukon. And water being one of our most precious resources, obviously we must maintain that. 80% of our proven fossil fuel reserves must stay in the ground in order to meet our global commitment to limit temperatures to below 2 degrees Celsius. there are no viable economic proven reserves in the Yukon. So any money, either private or public, invested in oil and gas exploration or development in the Yukon will likely be wasted. Or as they call it, it would be stranded assets. If your party becomes the government, are you prepared to risk taxpayers' money on a dying industry that is killing our planet, or will you instead invest taxpayers' dollars in renewable energy? Thank you.
Liz Hanson.
Thank you very much. And I thank Don for that question and for the incredible amount of work done over the past 5 years by Yukoners concerned to share information about the risks of fracking with thousands of Yukoners. The tabling of the 8,000 name petition was one of the highlights of the Yukon Legislative Assembly over the last 5 years. The Yukon NDP has been clear. People who live here have spoken, First Nation governments have spoken, and the scientific community has been clear about the dangers of fracking. It's time for action. We don't need a temporary moratorium or a pause on fracking. We need to ban it full stop. Now, there's some who will argue that Yukon has the necessary regulatory regime to proceed with conventional oil and gas development. Independent expert assessment of Yukon's oil and gas regulations raise serious questions about that. A Yukon NDP government will work with the federal government to fulfill commitments by the federal government dating back to 2009 to phase out fossil fuel subsidies. Instead of investing in an industry of the past, we will work with Yukoners, our federal and First Nation government partners, to invest in our future. The growth of the renewable energy sector worldwide is outstripping by far the fossil fuel sector in terms of good job creation, good jobs that build on existing and new skills that will keep Yukon jobs here, jobs that build a sustainable and resilient local economy.
Kristina.
Thank you, Don. As your question mentioned, scientists around the world are clearly stating that all remaining oil and gas reserves must be left in the ground to avoid unrecoverable temperature elevations. So the Yukon Green Party policy clearly states that we would ban fracking, we would not proceed with oil and gas exploration, we would phase out imports of oil, gas, and fossil fuels in general and replace them with renewable energy, and we would invest in renewable energy and energy efficiency that shifts the Yukon to a decarbonized economy. We have a very comprehensive section in our policy book to do with the ways that we would be phasing these things in and out, and the ways that we would be investing in renewable energy. And definitely this is a priority for the Yukon Green Party, because as many of us in the room here tonight know, we can't keep going the way that we're going. We need to look for other alternatives, and these alternatives exist all around the world. They're functioning economies in many jurisdictions that do not develop their oil and gas. We can do this here in the Yukon. We have the perfect climate for it, and the Yukon Green Party is ready to start that.
Thank you. And the microphone down to Danny Macdonald, please.
Thank you. As I stated earlier, the Yukon Party does support any responsible resource development in the territory. However, your question is regarding transferring over to renewable resources, and that is, of course, the preference that we have, and that's why we have the Next Gen Hydro Project is our initiative, and we have embarked on that, and recently the Yukon Party has included and expanded the scope to include smaller generation hydro renewables, including solar, wind, and biomass projects to build on our energy capacity in the territory. Currently, we are quite lucky to have our 95% of our on-grid energy is renewable, so we benefit from that. Of course, our preference is to expand that as much as possible, but we are faced with the reality that until we are capable of making that shift, we do have to have some reliance on fossil fuels. Thank you.
John Streicher.
Yeah, so, sorry, but 95% of our electricity is renewable, but not 95% of our energy. So if you're trying to figure out where we use fossil fuels in the territory, the two places
are transportation and heat. So the Liberals have identified that, and we are saying that the place to invest is to get us off of fossil fuels on heat. And we're significant investment, creating jobs, right? The Yukoners with skilled trades doing this. So that's the place where we can become more sustainable into the future. But I want to sort of point backwards that all of us talked about supporting land use planning. We talked about the North Yukon plan. We talked about, well, not all of us, but three of us talked about adopting the Peel land use plan as it was developed. And the Liberals are no to fracking. However, that those two land use plans say in there that Eagle Plains is identified for oil and gas. So which way do you want it? So as Liberals, we are saying that we will support those the land use planning process that were developed in a collaborative model with First Nations, and that those plans say, so the only way it's going to happen is if it's conventional, but if it does happen, it will be through land use planning where we need to address this. And so I'm not sure if we're talking about opening up the Peel land use plan. That's what I'm trying to figure out.
So, one more question, and I think, do I have to ask it? All right. It's terrible getting old. All right, so this is from Raven Recycling. There's no one from Raven here to ask you this question. It is a two-parter, the dreaded two-parter. So, there is a 22-year-old deposit refund system on most beverage containers, cans, and bottles in the Yukon. To stabilize the Yukon recycling system, we need to expand this deposit refund system to include more beverage containers like milk. So the question is, will you commit to this increase? I guess we'll ask that question right now, and we'll start with Kristina.
What? Yeah. Okay. This is a little confusing, Dave.
Welcome to my life.
So, yes, we would. This is the two-parter, or is this one of two?
One of two.
Okay.
One of two.
Yes, we would commit to raising this deposit.
Okay. Oh, great. Danny?
All right. In terms of, yes, I think this harkens back to the failed process that obviously the Chambers of Commerce indicated that the business community wasn't quite prepared to make these changes, so the changes were delayed. However, a re-elected Yukon Party government will be moving forward to including in the designated materials regulations, e-waste and rubber tile recycling, and including milk jugs in the beverage container regulations to support the current processors in place.
Thank you. Mr. Streicher.
Thanks, Dave. So for the first part, the answer is yes. The Liberals are committing to a territory-wide approach and moving towards a stewardship model, and that will include stages in which we introduce more that come under refundables.
And Liz?
Yes, it took 22 years to get the list expanded from one to a number, so we have, there's more to this question, so I think we'll get to it in the next phase, I hope.
I believe you're right, yes. Good job.
All right. Oh, sorry.
Up go the eyeglasses. We also need better management of materials at the end of their life. Would you implement a charge similar to what we have on tires to include things like computers, household hazardous waste, and motor vehicle oil? Let's go the same order, since it was the same question, more or less. Kristina? Adding things like computers, household hazardous waste, and motor oil.
Okay, I think that that would be an automatic yes for the Yukon Green Party, but also, as with many of the other questions you may have noticed here this evening, we would go even further than that, where I mentioned at one point we want to transition every Yukon landfill and transfer station into a materials recovery facility. So we would be directly working with sorting of materials, sorting of e-waste, and then we also, within our policy, have talked about extended producer responsibility. So this is the strategy that promotes the integration of environmental costs throughout the life cycle of a product. And we want to have extended producer responsibility. We want to have transfer stations and landfills all reclaiming materials, and we want to use these reclaimed materials to start an entire green economy with new jobs and the creation of local products made from reclaimed goods, and ending this kind of never-ending cycle of everything ending up in the landfills. And if any of you have a moment, you should really Google the Whitehorse landfill and think to yourselves, do I really want to be a part of this, or do I want to support a government that is going to put these deposits on these items and get these things recycled and keep them out of the landfills?
Mr. Macdonald.
So I guess I kind of addressed the second half a little bit there in terms of addition of e-waste and the designated materials regulation. So it would be begin with e-waste and rubber tire, and then with the beverage container regs, we would include milk jugs. However, any additional products that we were starting having a discussion in this product stewardship model, the one that we currently operate in, we'd go to work with our partners. Specifically, Yukon communities are very important partners in the recycling process because they are involved in managing the waste. So we would be working with the Association of Yukon Communities to identify future projects, or products rather, and then working with them on a funding model, as well as recycling processors and depots to sort and determine how we can best serve the recycling community.
John?
Thanks. When I was on the Association of Yukon Communities, we were trying to do that for many years. We recognize that this is a territory-wide issue. And as I said earlier, the Liberals believe in a stewardship model and will move us in that direction. It is a challenging thing. I just want to note, it was you, Dave, that asked the question. I was trying to get back to the person who asked. So the other thing that we've got to remember is that it isn't just about how we recycle stuff at the end. We've got to go further up the chain, right? So diverting waste in the first place or reducing so that we don't have it. And so it's all got to be part of it. So this is the last one of the suite of the recycling. But we would put it in there because we have to just become more sustainable. So the Liberals are moving ahead on a stewardship model in consultation with communities.
Liz Hanson.
Thank you very much. And the issue of recycling and zero waste management was in fact an election issue in 2011. In fact, Raven Recycling provided all members of the Legislative Assembly a copy of a blueprint for recycling in November of 2011. Imagine, if the Yukon Party had followed that blueprint, we would not be talking about these issues tonight. A Yukon NDP government will work with all levels of government in Yukon to minimize waste and maximize recycling and composting with the goal of achieving zero waste within Yukon by 2040. The issue of extended producer responsibility has in fact been mishandled by the Yukon Party government. At the Zero Waste Conference this spring, we heard that industry-led nonprofit stewardship councils in BC and Alberta were prepared to work with Yukon to implement EPR in Yukon. It makes sense to do this. We're a small territory. We can't do it on our own. Establishing these stewardship councils in a small jurisdiction is expensive. The Yukon NDP is prepared to work with Raven Recycling, AYC, local area councils, and other jurisdictions to make EPR a reality.
Thank you. We're going to take a short 10-minute break. There are some refreshments out in the lobby and another chance for you to write a question and submit it to the forum. The box is, if you go out, it's against this wall. That one. Not that one. This one.
Sorry about that last one. I mean, you know, we got 30 years of training. Says, don't ask two parters.
She says, how come he keeps looking at you?
So? Happy?
Yeah.
I'm going to turn this off.
Yeah.
More to save the batteries. So it looks
Okay. Okay.
Thank you. Yeah, are you going to come up?
Thank you.
Hello. We're going to start again. If we could get all the people who are wandering around by the old stuff to come back in here and hang out with us, get some questions. All right, so we're going to get going again. Says my boss for the evening, says we're going to get going again. Cell phones on mute. Wow, that's awesome. Okay, so where's Michael Dougherty? Gone? Are you serious? Well, how is he going to ask his question if he's gone? Oh my gosh. Okay.
Should I give it to
Dave? Oh, yeah, sure. I got nothing to do. Come on. I got to write my running list here.
Here you go, Michael.
Thank you very much. Michael Dougherty has like the greatest voice in town, so I cannot possibly do this. It's not going to happen, Liz. It's not going to happen. How do your... How do your environmental proposals impact on Yukon First Nations low-income citizens and new arrivees like our Syrian refugee families? There's two questions here. How do you propose to prepare our youth for the critical environmental challenge they will have to face mid-century? Let's start with that one. And we'll start with Kristina. How do you propose to prepare our youth for the critical environmental challenge they will have to face mid-century? I'm not actually Michael Dougherty. I don't know what he meant by that.
Well, I'm going to say that our children are kind of already facing it, and our youth are facing it right now. We're all facing it right now. And in every Yukon Green Party policy that we have put forward, we are including youth, First Nations, elderly, new arrivals. We're including every single Yukoner in how their lives will be and how their lives will be enriched by the conservation of Yukon environment and the sustainable management of our resources. Have a look at our policy book, yukongreenparty.ca. We have 34 pages of policy that we've worked very hard on to develop specifically for adapting to climate change, zero waste, creating jobs. As John has mentioned many times, the hand-in-hand with the economy and environment. We cannot have sustainable development without considering the environment. We cannot have a healthy environment without having a healthy economy and healthy communities to go hand in hand together for that. So First Nations, respecting the land claims agreements, respecting the umbrella final agreement, respecting the fact that we need to educate our youth on all of these issues, and we need to make sure that we're leaving future generations with something that they can be proud of.
Danny Macdonald, how do you propose to prepare our youth for the critical environmental challenge they will have to face mid-century?
Well, I think this goes back to some of the questions we actually had earlier about the on-the-land traditional knowledge that will be included in our schools, that it allows them to experience firsthand some of the changes that are occurring and preparing them for adaptation, because in the north, where we are disproportionately feeling the impacts of climate change, having them learning about the learning about the challenges that they're facing and experiencing are firsthand. In addition, part of our plan for dealing with climate change is to expand the Yukon University in developing a climate change degree, which will enable those youth who are interested in learning more and impacting and dealing with it and having and infecting change can do their research and learn more about it right here in Yukon at Yukon University when that becomes a reality. And as well, as they're growing up, one of the key components we're going to be developing is we will be doing a Energy 101 public education campaign, which will allow individual Yukoners and families to be better informed of what their personal energy uses is and what it really means to the territory so that they can create those changes in their lives that reduce their impact. Thank you.
John?
Right. So... the youth of today are already, let me just back up for a second. I've been teaching about climate change for 30 years, and so there are youth out there now who are now working as professionals in the trade. We've been working for a long time to shift the energy economy, and it's been very slow to start. I think it is going to happen within the next decades. It's starting, and I'm encouraged by what we have coming down the pipe for young people, but there's still a lot of change which is coming. So I think that the way that we do that is by educating our young people around these issues, getting them out on the land, getting them experienced, making sure that we create jobs within transitioning the energy economy away from fossil fuels to a low carbon, to a no carbon future. And right up to research and development around this. So in the future, we will have a different type of economy here, a knowledge-based economy more, and one which is based on local production and local agriculture and the ability to sustain ourselves here over the long term. And that's what I hope for our kids.
Ms. Hanson?
Thanks, Dave. I think the first part of the question you asked had to do with the social equity aspect of it with respect to climate change, the policies that we'd be applying.
Sure.
So one of the that's what I heard you talking about in terms of low-income individuals and perhaps new Yukoners, and I think that's one of the principles that we've been very clear about, that we accept that there will be a price on carbon. And it's just like as we have accepted in Canada that many of our public goods and services are provided through our tax base. And what we're saying is that as we look to make the transition from fossil fuels to renewable energy, that carbon pricing is one tool, but we need to ensure that low and middle income families are not more negatively impacted by this. So we talk about the principle of ensuring that there's some form of rebate to those families, to those individuals, as well as investing the balance of the tax income into renewable energy. And that is part of achieving what you're talking in the second part of the question, which is how we as Canada, how we as Yukon meet our 2050 goals in terms of zero net energy. And that is going to be a critical part of working with First Nations around fulfilling the commitments in the Land Claims Agreement around the precautionary principle of ensuring sustainable development. I think we can do it, but we have to work in terms of we're talking about system change here. That doesn't take it overnight. It is a transition, it's step by step. It means committing to strategic goals, setting targets, and working towards them.
Thank you. Dave Lokes. Is Dave Lokes around? Yeah. A microphone is coming. Look out. It's right there. All right. Go ahead.
Well, my question actually has been answered abundantly in the first part.
Fantastic.
So I really don't need to answer it because it was inquiring if to each of you, if your parties would commit to supporting and adopting the final recommended plan of the Peel Planning Commission. We've already heard about this. So please feel free to comment further or we can take another question.
What do you guys, would you? All right, well, let's, your question, Dave, your question is, will you commit to the Peel plan? The don't come in here with your own crazy rules. So, Dave, your question was the original Peel plan, the final recommended plan. Will your government commit to it? We will start with Liz Hanson. If you want to just put up your hand, Liz, that would make at least one other person happy.
I think I'd like to just simply put up my hand, but there is a nuance to this because it is before the Supreme Court of Canada, and it is really important that the Supreme Court of Canada uphold the ruling of the Yukon Supreme Court, because as you'll recall, the Yukon Court of Appeal pushed back on some of the recommendation, some of the ruling from Justice Vail. And in order to ensure the integrity of the final recommended plan, the integrity of land use planning under Chapter 11 of our final agreements, we must have the ruling that came out of the Yukon Supreme Court and not the Yukon Court of Appeal. So Yukon NDP government will change the instructions that have been provided to government lawyers to date. We will ensure that our instructions to the new lawyers that we'll be putting in place will be to basically be a friend of the plan. And I'm not sure what the legal language of it is, but we can't stop the process of going to the Supreme Court, nor do we want to. We want to have the integrity of the final recommended plan.
Kristina?
Agreed with everything Liz has said, and also, yes, we would support protection of the Peel and support of the plan, but also, as John was mentioning earlier, there are, you know, I don't want to be caught in a position where I have said, yes, the Yukon Green Party supports the protecting the Peel, and then have Don say, well, but it says right in that land use plan that we allow for natural gas exploration within that land use plan. So yes, we support that, but mainly our position is that we're supporting the fact that this was 8 years of consultation, this is the public, this is the stakeholders, this is what they want, and that's what the Green Party wants to support.
Danny Macdonald.
Thank you. So as stated, I actually agree with Liz that it is important that the Supreme Court completes their ruling. That is very important throughout this whole process, that it will provide clarity to not just to governments, but to government officials on both sides, and to citizens of Yukon, and to lawyers who are providing advice moving forward. Once that ruling has come in, it provides clarity to everyone on what must be followed and what the obligations are under the Umbrella Fine Agreement. And that is very important for everyone to understand. And that clarity sometimes is only available through the Supreme Court. That being said, the government believes that we understand, and the process was very important and very useful, because everyone now understands there will be significant protection in the Peel. And Yukon Party believes that we have to sit down with First Nation governments, government to government, and negotiate once this is completed in the clarity, to determine what that is. Thank you.
John Streicker.
Right. Well, so I'll stick up my hand to start with, just to say that we support the land use plan for the Peel as developed by the commission. And while I appreciate that we need to follow through on this court case and see it all the way, I still think we need to. We're doing the wrong thing here. We don't want to use the courts as a means of planning our use of land in the territory. It's the wrong tool altogether. We need to reinvest in land use planning. Do you know why? It's not. If you are a proponent and you want to develop somewhere, like let's say a mine or something, you're not worried about land use planning. You're worried about uncertainty. That if you are trying to invest money, that you don't know whether something is going to be okay or not. So land use planning helps us to start to say what's okay where. And so we should be using this as a tool, and we should be really reinvesting in planning and working far forward. We're on too short of a time cycle with these elections, because last election I recall us asking the same question, and I still wish that I could hear whether we were all going to stick up our hands or not. So I loved that suggestion. Thank you very much.
All right, Davina Harker. We're looking for Davina. And here comes your microphone.
Good evening, and thank you for being here. I'd like to ask you to suspend your knowledge of Northern Cross being in the land use plan and answer this question outside of that spectrum. Could each candidate give a fulsome response why they would support or not support Northern Cross exploration and development during your elected tenure? Please include in the answer your party's consideration regarding economics, water, air, wildlife, permafrost, contamination, and waste disposal management methodologies such as carry away or sump pumps. So I would like you to address directly your belief in whether you support or don't support Northern Cross, and then I'd like your business case.
Well, it's 90 seconds, so I don't know if that's really fair, to be honest. Well, guess who gets to go first? John Streicker.
Wow. Okay, so no fracking. And the North Yukon plan and the Peel plan say that there is an area there that is identified for oil and gas. So if it's going to go forward under the Liberals, it must be... Did you just ring that bell? Wow.
That was an accidental ring.
Sorry.
I know it Kay. Felt like a...
Premature bell. Okay. Sorry. sorry. It would have to be conventional. So we're trying to remove... We just said on the independent power producer policy, the Yukon Liberals are removing LNG, so no subsidizing LNG under the IPP. And so we're not willing to invest in oil and gas, but if it were, if the Vuntut-Gwich'in First Nation who asked to put that in the plan were wanting to do it, then we would follow that through the regulatory process. It is my hope that we don't develop oil and gas here in the territory. It is not the right direction for us as a territory, but we are supportive of the land use plan.
Liz Hanson.
There's two parts to the question, the answer that I would give. One is I think that the North Yukon land use plan does not determine or say that oil and gas should be developed. It recognizes that there has been historic oil and gas exploration activity in that area. And that leads to my second comment, which is that in August of 2011, I attended the Vuntut-Gwich'in General Assembly, at which Northern Cross and their new partner, CNOOC, attended. And they laid out for the community their plans for drilling in the Northern Cross license area. And they pointed out to the community that they plan to spend a couple of years focusing on conventional oil and gas exploration, and then they plan to move to unconventional. And that was not my GA. I didn't say anything, but the community said, a person held up his hand, he said, we read the National Geographic. You're talking about fracking. That's not going to happen in our territory.
Kristina?
Yes, the Yukon Green Party definitely, as we stated before, we do not support further exploration, development, subsidization of oil and gas or fossil fuel energy at all for that point. Of course, we're not naive, we're not pie in the sky. We realize there is a transition period, but from our point of view, there are millions of dollars from our government being paid to oil and gas, mining, polluting industries. These subsidies can all be shifted over to renewables. These subsidies can all be shifted over to environmentally, socially, and economically net positive industries. We can create a burgeoning, healthy, green economy with lots of jobs that our youth and our people in general can be proud of. They can say to themselves, you know, here I am performing a job which I'm getting paid well for on my traditional territory, and I'm protecting it. I am helping it. I'm cleaning it. I am not poisoning it and feeling this kind of inner pain of, here, I need to feed my kids, but guess what? I just wrecked where I fish from. So, so we definitely cannot. We recognize the importance of transitioning, decarbonizing. We have to do that, and we have to start now.
And we'll hear from Danny Macdonald now.
Thank you. Well, starting off, as I noted, the Yukon Party does support any responsible resource development in the territory. However, I think a key to this is we have to discuss that each individual application has to be considered on its merits. And we have an entire regime in place that assesses this through our assessment regime and our regulatory regime. And in the case of Northern Cross, if I'm recalling correctly, they went through that regime, and concerns with caribou restricted some of what was occurring. So making declarative statements and making presupposing what may occur, we have to allow the processes that we put in place for the consideration and the input of our partners, including First Nation governments especially, to allow those processes to unfold before we actually make a decision. That's responsible government once you have those regimes in place. So I would say, you know, I can't stand here and say I can make an assessment on it, because if someone comes forward with that proposal, you have to allow the process to unfold. And that would be my sort of consideration on this. And you have to allow it to go to its completion, and you expect that it comes to the right conclusion. Thank you.
And now Molly Pratt. Is Molly Pratt in the room? And what's up? Hello. Oh, did I skip one?
I think you may have skipped the last of the...
Oh, okay. Gary Beamish? Beamis?
Okay, well, the Yukon has the Yukon Environment Act in place, and part of that Environment Act states that the environment belongs to all Yukoners. It doesn't belong to a government or a legislature. It belongs to all Yukoners, and the legislature is actually the custodian of the Yukon environment, which belongs to all Yukoners. So in order to protect the environment, there was a council on the economy, which was the watchdog in case a government of the day did something against the Environment Act, and then there was supposed to be an arm's length body that you could go to further the complaint about an environmental problem. However, the last legislature did away with that council and gave it to a minister to be able to have the discretion whether there's going to be a council or not, which he effectively
Can we get the question,
okay,
please?
Well, I'm just laying out the premise
here. Can we get
here.
To the question, please?
So anyways, if you were elected to government, would you commit to passing legislation? We've heard a lot of banter about banning fracking in the territory, but would you pass legislation banning fracking in the Yukon Territory, repeal the Yoga Gas Act of 2015, the amendments, and repeal the Yukon Environment Act amendment, which took away the council within 90 days of being elected?
Okay. Danny Macdonald, you get to start this one.
All right. Extensive list there. I would believe a number of the changes were done for the Environment Act, the council. It was done under Yukon Party government, but part of that process was due to the developing assessment regime in the territory and the modernization of our assessment regime, it was felt that we have a number of boards and committees, including the Fish and Wildlife Management Board, Renewable Resource Councils, the Yukon Environmental Assessment, Socioeconomic Assessment Board. These tools are now in place and had now replaced the process that was being undertaken by the council that you're referencing. In terms of shale gas development, the Yukon Party has been clear that it is not taking place in the territory and there's none planned in the territory. And when this became a concern, they implemented an all-party committee and accepted the 21 recommendations of that all-party committee, of which two key ones that are being worked on are collection of baseline data and that no development would take place without the support of affected First Nations. And that remains the position today, and I have nothing else to add on that. Thanks.
John Streicker.
Right, so the Liberals are committing to effectively bringing back that council. I've referred to it several times in speaking to you tonight about a task force on the economy and the environment, which is independent, which is comprised of industry, NGO, and also governments, all orders of government. And even though we have a regulatory regime with many groups, what we're lacking is this idea about planning and thinking long term into the future, and even about where we should make legislative changes so that it will move us in the right direction. For example, if you want to put in place a ban on fracking, one of the things that's, if you want it territory-wide, then you want to sit down with First Nations and develop it that way. So we're committing to bringing that table together and then to see through that table what pieces of legislation they recommend to amend. So that would be the way that we tackle it. Thanks.
Liz?
Thank you very much. The Environment Act was an act that was created by an NDP government. The Yukon Council of the Environment was established pursuant to that act. It was not because there was duplication of bodies or whatever. It was because the Harper government got rid of the Canadian Council on the Economy and the Environment, that the Yukon government basically disbanded the Yukon Council. It's interesting to note that the final agreements do reference First Nation participation on the Yukon Council of the Economy and the Environment, so it seems a bit strange that we don't have this established body. So of course we will change it back from may to shall. A minister shall appoint a Yukon Council of the Economy and the Environment. A Yukon NDP government will repeal the provisions or the amendments that were made with respect to yoga, which dealt with the Yukon Party taking away the consent provisions that the NDP government had put in place in 1997. And the last question, yes, of course, we will ban fracking.
And finally, Kristina Calhoun.
It's so interesting to have the responses go ahead of mine because it's so much food for thought. The Yukon Green Party does certainly want to see less government. So to Danny's point, as far as him saying that there was all these other bodies, so they felt like they could get rid of it. Certainly, if that is the case, the Yukon Green Party supports less government, less duplication, less use of resources. But as we know, that isn't necessarily the case. So we would bring that council back because that is very important to have that third party, that out-of-reach entity that when things are getting a little tense, we need to have that other body to be able to safely pull back and look at this from an objective point of view and give us the results that all Yukoners want to see.
Molly Pratt. Where is Molly?
Okay, so this is a question from Molly. It's from the Arctic Institute of Community-Based Research in Whitehorse. We can't talk about environment and climate change without talking about food security. Food insecurity in the North is both an outcome of a changing climate, but food security planning can also be a solution to ensuring a safe, healthy environment for the future. Good food policy is good economic policy, good agriculture policy, good health policy, and good environmental policy. Our food system is one of the major contributors to greenhouse gas emissions, so food security is fundamentally linked to countering the clock on climate change. What are some of the policies that your party is proposing that will contribute to ensuring we have a safe, sustainable, nutritious, affordable food system for the future?
Kristina? Oh. Yes.
I know that you guys are going to think I'm a broken record because I keep saying, look at our policy book, but it's really great, and we worked very hard on it. And we have two entire pages devoted to food security and food sovereignty here in the Yukon. We want to see integration of food preparation, food growing, canning, right in the curriculum of schools. We want our children to know how to grow food here in the Yukon, how to forage local foods here in the Yukon, and how to make sure that they can have a nice full cold room to get them through the winter. We want that to perpetuate right up through adulthood. We want everyone who lives in the Yukon to have self-sufficiency. We don't want to be relying on bringing things up if we don't have to. The more that we can grow here, the more barriers we remove to make growing here easier, the less we have to truck up from down south. And I know you all remember what happened when the roads were closed and everyone rushed Superstore, and we don't need that happening here. We have so many valuable people working so hard in different organizations here in the Yukon. We have organic farmers, we can get a lot of our stuff here locally, and we need our governments to recognize that we need to support the growth in agriculture here locally, and we also need to teach people, you know, how do we effectively use this? How do we get it to last through the winter? How do we best manage our wildlife populations so that we can eat wild game without depleting our resources?
Let's just go down the line. I'm getting tired of this. Keeping track of stuff.
Okay. So the Yukon Liberals, we've built into our platform local food production and agriculture as a sustainable future, as a means to diversify our economy. In particular, what we identified was building infrastructure to support community-based greenhouses throughout all communities in the territory, food storage options, food processing options. And so the thing about local food gathering and local food production, these are sustainable futures for us. So it's how we adapt to climate change. It's also how we mitigate against climate change. It's how we develop and diversify our local economy. So the Liberals have identified it as, the one other thing that we identified was using community-based greenhouses as education. And we've got some great models starting with Trondikwichen, and we hope to expand that across the whole of the territory.
Liz?
Thank you a lot, very much. And I think that the work that the Arctic Institute has been doing is really, really important, and I'm seeing the results in communities across the territory. The NDP, of course, has key elements of our platform to support a local agricultural industry. We do see this as an important part of the transition of our economy to a more resilient and durable economy. And I like what John just said about the Trondikwichen teaching farm. I spent some time there this summer, and it's a really good model that you see. It's similar to what we've seen in other areas of our communities as we look at how we begin to reinstate in communities some of the skills that generations of the past had. You know, in the old days, you had farms, you had gardens, and you had food storage. We need to bring that back in every single community so that we do have an economy and the security of knowledge that we have food that's not dependent of fly-in and fly-out, but it's also the notion that we used to have warehouses in this territory that would where we'd have food storage. We don't have that anymore. We depend on the same kind of food delivery systems they have in down south. It doesn't work up here when you have the kind of inclement weathers and other events that take it away from our control. So what supporting a local agricultural industry does is puts more control at the local level.
Danny.
Thank you. Thank you. The Yukon Party's roadmap for local food is they recently launched a local food strategy in the last couple of years, and that is the roadmap for a reelected Yukon Party government when it comes to implementing local food. Included in it are short-term and medium-term and long-term goals to A, build on agriculture, expand the opportunities for its sale in the territory, and to also cultivate more traditional activities for hunting and harvesting. However, I have to be frank that I am not as familiar with the document as I would like to share with you further details. So if you are interested in that subject, it is available online, and I would encourage you to go take a look at it. All right, thanks.
Thank you. John Glenn Morris. And this is the final question. No pressure.
Great.
Yeah.
Okay. With respect to the environment, what do you hope your party, if government, will be most remembered for by future generations? In other words, what do you want to be proud of with respect to the environment?
Because John Streicher is holding the microphone, I'm going to make him go first.
Thanks, Dave.
You're welcome.
I'm holding the microphone because it somehow defaults to me. What would I like to be proud of? It's sustainability, for sure. So one of the challenges of any government is to take long-term decisions. One of the things that you always get pushed towards is short-term decision-making. And it's really important that we think longer than a five-year election cycle or whatever the election cycle, you know, is. But it's just not long enough. So what we really need to be doing is thinking longer term. And if there were one thing that I would be proud of as a Liberal government, it would be that we would think far into the future as we plan forward. So when we started looking at where there was room to change here, the place that we identified right away was in how we use fossil fuels for heat here. That's a place where we have the skill set and we could develop a lot of skilled jobs around this, and we could actually move the economy forward, which is lagging right now. And that's something that I would be super proud of if we started down that path where we created a more sustainable future for the territory.
Liz Hanson.
Speaking of the future generations, so if we look at our target for 2050, then it would be that we had responsibly, in a manner that's socially and economically responsible, transition from fossil fuels to a renewable energy future, that we had done so in a manner that brought along all sectors of our society, that left no one behind, that ensured that the future generations are not burdened with a larger debt in terms of the impacts of climate change than we're already leaving them. So it would be that we carefully thought out how we make this transition and that we worked to make the system changes that will be necessary to bring it about so that our kids' kids will not be dealing with the what looks like the inevitable climate change impacts that we're seeing across the world. And so it really is that simple thing about that we made the transition and we did it in a socially and economically responsible manner.
Danny?
Thank you. I concur that when we look back upon, we want to be in a position that we look back and say that we aggressively tackled climate change in a way that affects change, and it actually will reduce our emissions and allow us to adapt. However, I think it's clear that one thing that we all value here is the quality of life and the ability to live here and the ability to work here and the ability to raise our family here. So when the look at how we went about dealing with these challenges, that we are dealing still with the short-term obligations and the short-term challenges that we face, and we worked in a way that still enabled us all to enjoy the quality of life that we all value so much, and that we were able to continue to live here. And that this government is about doing what we have to do to tackle those challenges while enabling people to continue to enjoy their lives here. Thank you.
Finally, Kristina.
Well, I'm going to go out on a limb here because I think that the Yukon Green Party government, what we would be most proud of is the very first thing we would do is we would change the electoral system to proportional representation. And I know you're probably wondering, how does that affect the environment? Well, I think it really affects the environment because look at all these people in this room tonight. Three quarters of them are, I'm going to be diplomatic here. Many of us in the room here tonight have very strong feelings, passion for our Yukon environment. Many of us, if we were properly represented, we would have these changes in place already. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, so we're going to move on to closing statements now and wrap up the forum. And can I get a round of applause for the organizers of the forum? I think it's been a great night. And the staff at the Beringia Center as well. And whoever put the padding on the chairs, because those things used to be terribly uncomfortable. So, once again, the baseball cap and the numbers were employed to come up with the order of the closing statements, and it begins with Kristina Calhoun of the Green Party.
Okay, so thank you all very much for the opportunity to participate tonight. It says a lot to these fine Yukon organizations and also to you citizens to display this level of inclusion and respect to the Yukon Green Party as a less established yet growing party. Much of this election is centered on green issues. You may have noticed the other parties falling over each other and going on about their green plans and policies. And like it or not, this is partly because of the Yukon Green Party. We are moving the bar greenwards. And we're happy and proud to be here to ensure that the land, the water, and low-impact Yukoners have a voice at this table here tonight. I thought it would be a table, but it's tables. At these tables here tonight. The Yukon Green Party has good, sound, common-sense policies. We have worked very hard creating them and researching them, and they're all based on existing policies that are being practiced in other parts of the world. I encourage each and every one of you here tonight to visit our website, yukongreenparty.ca, read our policy book, pick two or three policies that you like, and ask the candidate that you plan to vote for if they or their party will implement these policies if elected. Better yet, elect a Green, and trust one of us with the opportunity to bring these smart policies and respectful values forward in the legislature. Whatever the outcome, hold the next government, whoever it consists of, to their environmental promises made to you here this evening. And ask them directly to adopt good, healthy, green policies. And after all, without healthy and diverse ecosystems, we cannot sustain a healthy economy or healthy communities. Carbon tax, guaranteed livable income, bulk purchase prescription drugs, territory-wide transit system, enshrine the right to a healthy environment, replace first past the post with proportional representation. These are all great policies, and they are all with you in mind.
Thank you, Kristina. Danny Macdonald, closing statements.
Thank you all, and tonight you've seen a number of differing plans for the territory and its environment. And I think the one issue that we all know we need to address is climate change, and the Yukon Party has an aggressive government plan to address climate change. And unless you haven't been paying attention, I think it's clear we're the only party that believes we can do that without implementing a carbon tax in the territory. We know it's going to take significant government investment, and we'd rather do that without putting that cost on Yukon families. Our retrofit program that we're committing to with government buildings is over $80 million, and it creates long-term, green, good-paying jobs for Yukoners. Initial estimates suggest it'll save us over $4 million, or approximately $4 million a year, and will reduce our greenhouse gas emissions by 6,000 tons. That's approximately 15% of Yukon government's emissions, or 1% of the total emissions in the territory. We've doubled the green energy
program, which we announced today for residential and commercial incentive programs, to $4 million. That program is always oversubscribed. And this will benefit more Yukoners who are able to green their homes and make them less emitting, and also provide work for the people who are doing that. And it's kind of neat. I'm excited about this one. We did an announcement as well that we're going to actually implement green electric fleet vehicles for mail delivery. Part of that commitment is building 8 charging stations around Whitehorse that other residents will be able to take advantage of that with electric cars. That mail fleet is the highest emitting portion of the fleet vehicle agency. We'll continue investing in the next gen hydro, which will include consideration of smaller hydroelectric sites, other forms of renewable energy, such as solar, wind, and biomass, not strictly the large hydro. And we will work with First Nations, renewable resource councils, and communities to ensure the health of our fish stocks, explore options for ensuring the long-term health of salmon populations, and we'll manage our healthy wildlife populations. Thank you.
Thank you, Danny. Liz Hanson.
Right. Well, thank you all for being here tonight. And it's really clear that we know from the people that are here tonight and from the conversation that we choose to live here for a reason. Yukon's pristine wilderness is at the heart of what makes this place unique. The Yukon NDP has a solid record of recognizing a healthy environment and a healthy economy. Our economy and our future depends on our ability to acknowledge that we are, as Catherine McClelland and Lucy Burkle put it, part of the land and part of the water. NDP MLAs have echoed the voices of Yukoners on the peel, on fracking, on species at risk, on renewable energy, on solid waste management, on responsible mining, on renewable energy. It's time to turn the page on a government that is focused on energy sources of the past. Yukoners have spoken. First Nation governments have spoken, and the science community is clear. We don't need a temporary moratorium or pause on fracking. We need to ensure it does not happen here. That's why an NDP government will ban fracking and focus our efforts on transitioning to a renewable energy future. Renewable energy provides huge potential for good, stable jobs for Yukoners. It's why Yukon NDP government will invest $50 million in a green energy investment fund. Climate change is real. The status quo is not an option for future generations. But there is hope. We need bold leadership to foster innovation and to make Yukon a leader in renewable energy. So let's build a better, greener Yukon for everyone. It's about time, I think.
Thank you, Liz. John Streicher.
I'd like to thank fellow candidates for being here tonight, and all of you. I think we're all passionate about where we live, and we want a future that is going to be sustainable for not just us, but all future generations. It is critical that we get these decisions right as we go forward now. I think we've been waiting too long and have been lagging in actually addressing these deep and critical issues. And it's not about having to choose between the economy and the environment. That is a thing of the past, and we really need to move forward. The only way that we have forward is to see how the economy and the environment work together, so that when we take decisions looking into the future, we do so in a way which will not compromise future generations or even current generations. When I started working in climate change, we used to think that it was going to be coming, as Michael Dougherty said, somewhere in mid-century. But now we understand that it's here already. And when I started off tonight, I talked to you about the Kaskawalsh Glacier. And it is deeply concerning to us, or all of us as Yukoners, that these changes are here. And we're still just about taking responsibility. But now is the time to take responsibility. Now is the time to put in place decisions so that we don't burden future generations to have to deal with, what did Forrest Pearson say the other day? If we don't pay for it now, we'll just be charging our kids more for it later. And that's not the right way to do it. So we need to put the economy and the environment together, and we need to work with all orders of government respectfully in particular First Nations governments, and that's how we're going to create a more prosperous future for the Yukon.
Thank you very much. And thank you all for coming. Oh, wait, hold, sit down.
Hi, I know we're running past time, so I'll be brief, but I do have a couple closing remarks that I think you'll be interested in. So a full evening, lots to reflect on, lots to be hopeful, passionate about. My name is Kristina Macdonald. I'm the Executive Director of the Yukon Conservation Society, and YCS has worked with CPAWS Yukon to bring this environment forum to you tonight with pleasure. I'd first like to thank the party representatives here tonight for sharing with us their party's positions on these important environmental issues. Kristina Calhoun, candidate with the Yukon Green Party, John Streicker with the Yukon Liberals, Liz Hanson, leader of the Yukon NDP, and Danny Macdonald, candidate with the Yukon Party. So if we could give them a round of applause, please. Thank you to Dave White for his skillful moderation of a very full agenda. And thank you here at the Beringia Center for your thoughtful questions, and to the people tuning in online across the territory and beyond, because there are matters that we discussed here tonight that concern the country, if not the world. So thank you for your thoughtful questions. We had over 30 questions submitted. We weren't able to ask all of them, but they were excellent questions. And what we are going to do is put them online on our websites so that the parties can answer them. We hope they will answer them because they're all excellent questions. And we did our best to get a diversity of questions answered here tonight. So YCS and CPAWS Yukon are working hard this election to make the environment a priority. One of the things we'd like to let you know about is that we sent an environment questionnaire to all the four parties here tonight. Their answers are in hand. There are print copies available on the table as you leave. These responses are also going to be made available online, and we're going to be putting them in the newspaper. If you haven't received our vote for the peel door hanger, we also have copies of those available as you leave. And you may have noticed a large friendly caribou on your way in. And so we ask you to watch for Boo in the next 3 weeks in the lead up to the election, because CPAWS and YCS are going to be going door to door and asking you about your key environmental issues and making sure we distribute the party's responses to all who are interested. So how we approach the key environmental challenges and opportunities we are facing today will have lasting impacts on our culture, our economy, and the natural environment that sustains us all. I encourage you to talk with your friends, your family, your colleagues, and continue the discussion we had tonight. Talk to the party candidates that come to your door over the next 3 weeks and ask them how they will take strong action on the environmental issues that matter to you and to sustaining our northern way of life. And above all, make sure that you vote on November 7th. So good night, everyone, and thank you all again. Thank you for our sign language translator tonight. It's Amanda, it's a lot of work. And be safe on your travels here tonight. It's icing up out there. So good night, everyone.
Go, go, go.